My name is Herbert Grimes. I serve as the interim president of this very esteemed institution. And I'd like to share a few comments with you this morning. We have some prepared remarks that I'm going to read from, and then I'll be open for questions thereafter. Let me share this, first of all, again, having welcomed you to this historic location. This, of course, is the Bethune Room here in the library. And as you can tell from the paintings and photographs on the wall, it's historic in nature. It captures a lot of the essence of our founder and certainly shows a number of the things that she was successful in doing, including service for the U.S. government. Bethune-Cookman, of course, is at a pivotal crossroads, and the future of this exceptional institution requires a commitment of resources, strategic planning, and leadership. I'm actually here today to address the crisis that threatens the continued viability and very existence of our beloved university. More importantly, I offer a pathway to emerge from the challenges that I inherited some 15 months ago. Our nearly 4,000 students deserve the same excellence in leadership from my administration that we expect from them when they leave this historic institution. Less than 2 weeks ago, 40 of our outstanding young alumni were celebrated for their success stories, crossing careers from medicine to cybersecurity to law enforcement to cultural anthropology and more. Given time, the current group of students will join their ranks, well prepared and ready. First, let me address the student protests that occurred yesterday. While many have criticized the students, I believe this peaceful gathering represents the sincere dedication of many of our students to urge us to do better, move quicker, and find solutions. Student protests at Bethune-Cookman historically have helped to change our state and reshape our nation. My meetings with student leadership, as recent as last evening, have been earnest and will continue as we seek common ground. I applaud their intellect, judgment, and character as they express their concerns about their beloved institution. Understand, we prefer our students to be in class to learn, and I've expressed that to them directly. Yet, we all have an enormous stake in rescuing our university from the tragic fate that has befallen other HBCUs. When I took on this assignment, I pledged to do all that I could within my power to save, stabilize, and grow our beloved institution. I believe we've made significant progress, but much remains to be done. To that end, I'll be sharing a copy of the President's report card, which covers the positive developments and achievements over the past year with each of you if you desire at the conclusion of our message here this morning. Second, we're in the midst of a crisis that challenges every facet of this university. The students, the faculty, the administration, staff, and board of trustees, along with the alumni and community that's been enhanced by our existence. As many of you are aware, our problems reflect the culmination of years of inadequate accountability, suspect governance, and quite frankly, inexcusable management decisions. In the last 5 years, we've experienced an existential threat to our legacy and our existence, the suspension of our accreditation, and a debt balloon in excess of $100 million. While my administration did not create these issues, we have no time to waste assessing blame. As our illustrious founder, Dr. Bethune, once said, without faith, nothing is possible. Yet with faith, nothing is impossible. Third, I stand before you today acknowledging the difficulty of our plight, but confident of our ability to emerge unscathed with our probation lifted, accreditation extended, our finances restored, and our administration and faculty delivering a quality education to our students. It's clear we did not devolve overnight to our present set of circumstances, and we will need patience and planning to overcome the crisis. There's little to be gained by detailing the unfortunate and potentially fatal financial decisions made related to our dorm transaction. However, at the appropriate time, we'll make all of the documents available to any interested parties to affirm the catastrophic consequences that must be remedied with dispatch. Clearly, a $100 million debt balloon would challenge the finances of any HBCU. And accordingly, we have enlisted the best financial and legal minds to help us in crafting both short-term action and thoughtful, sustainable, long-term plans to restore our financial stability, which is at the core of our dilemma. Undoubtedly, the dorm transaction looms as our major financial hurdle, but other governance and financial issues have festered and further exacerbate the crisis. Transparency demands that I note that scholarship discrepancies have confounded our administration and are contributing to our financial issues. This was true in more than one category, some of which we've been able to address, while others remain. If students present themselves at our university believing that their costs are covered by scholarships that are unfunded, we have a problem that must be resolved. We've never strayed from our founders' belief that a thirst for education is the essential investment in the human soul. Our challenge is making certain that we have sufficient resources available to quench that thirst. Finally, we must allow our students to learn, our outstanding faculty to instruct, and our administration to lead. Our issues of governance clearly concern the accrediting organizations, and we intend to have frank discussions with our board, faculty, students, to delineate definable lines of responsibility in order for our administration to be successful in leading this university forward. I pledge openness as a prerequisite for victory, and which also means, though, that there are times when we may not be able to tell you everything that's going on behind the scenes until such time as those things are concretized. Yet, all the documents and transactions that preceded my administration will be available at the appropriate time, and many of these are already available in the public domain. All of our plans that offer relief from our debt crisis and those that have been, who have been developed, once those are finalized, will then be made available. All of our constituents, students, faculty, administrators, trustees, alumni, and believers in our mission must join together to rescue an institution that's been a beacon of hope and inspiration since its founding. I love Bethune-Cookman, long before I took on the title of being the interim president, and therefore, collectively, with faith in God, the hallmark of our institution, we will not fail. However, we do need help in completing this journey. I'm inviting those who are willing to help to join me for a community roundtable to further share ideas and support for the institution that has an annual economic impact of over $300 million in this community. Thank you very much.